When it first happened, the minutes felt like hours. The hours felt like days. And the horror of what happened, one detail after another, could hardly be processed, much less understood. Then days turned into weeks, and weeks turned into years. Memorials were built. Wars were fought. Victims' names were read. Survivors tried to pick up the pieces, over and over again. But no matter how much time has passed, we vow to hold these memories. We will never forget those who were taken from us. The world changes and shifts this way and that. But one thing stays constant. One thing is steady. God. God weeps with us. God mourns with us. God bottles up our tears and records them in His book. He is closer to you than your own breath, and remains the cornerstone of life. God is the solid ground holding us up as the world moves beneath us. It's as true today as it was on that day. Our God reigns. He reigns over principalities and powers. His dominion stretches beyond what our eyes can see. And when the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, our God reigns. We will always remember.
That's good. This next video clip that I want to share with you this morning is personal because it happens to be one of our own that was interviewed a week or so ago, and it was aired on Friday, Channel 9, and Sergeant Jason Snow, God bless you. God bless you, sir. And so this is a short clip on Friday.
Tomorrow marks 20 years since the 9/11 attacks. We've been talking about it now, of course, all week. Many of us remember where we were that Tuesday morning in 2001. Jason Snow was at work at the time, driving a forklift in a factory, 4 years after he'd ended his time as a U.S. Navy sailor. But as anchor Adrian Whitsett explains, the pull of duty had soon returned.
These are the big guns, the Avengers of the Ohio National Guard's 1st 174th Air Defense Artillery Regiment. Sergeant First Class Jason Snow is the battalion master gunner.
There's been a series of deployments from Germany to Iraq to Washington, D.C.
But that wasn't supposed to happen. Snow had already served. Out of high school in the 90s, Snow joined the Navy, spent 4 years traversing the globe, and got out. Then, about 4 years later, the first, then second tower of the World Trade Center fell.
And then another coworker said the Pentagon just got hit. And I said, well, that's impossible. You can't get near the Pentagon. I knew at that moment that, you know, we are under attack and I need to do something personally.
After the initial shock of the attack, Snow's previous training kicked in.
During that time, you know, I see all my coworkers and, you know, just the community. They're in fear of what's next, what's to come. Are we going to get attacked again? So I felt like I couldn't sit the sideline and watch people in fear and my families.
So he joined the Ohio National Guard in January 2002.
I was mentally prepared, yes. Already having the military background and knowing what it takes to be successful and to lead, I had those already. We supported
that. Now looking back on 20 years of duty and experience, Snow's tasked with getting the next generation of soldiers prepared before he retires next year.
That gives me the opportunity to get the soldiers ready for the high up-tempo deployments that we have, you know, around the country and overseas as well.
Protection at home and abroad, part of a mission that turned a sailor into a soldier, feeling the pull of duty from ground zero.
So 20 years ago, you know, we never dreamt that this would happen. You know, it hasn't happened since Pearl Harbor. And now it's reality. It's our day-to-day reality and the way the world is now.
Adrian Whitsett, WCPO 9 News.
Ahead of Patriot.
Thank you, Sergeant. First class also mentioned Master Gunner, and there's only 5 Master Gunners in the state of Ohio. Am I correct about that? Am I correct about that? 5. And he's one of them, so I feel pretty safe right now, you know? God bless you, Sergeant. All right. The last clip I want to show you happened about, of course, 20 years ago. And that weekend that happened, I gave my message. And then the message after that, I became pastor. So that was September the 9th in 2001. And then my wife and I went away, and then we came back. And matter of fact, I think Billy and Sheila, we were with y'all down there in Florida. And when all this happened, and so when I came back, I thought, I would really like to honor our policemen, our first responders, firemen. And so I called the city of New York. I just chose a fire department up there, and a Chief Santangelo answered. And I said, Chief, I don't know if someone there from your department, we want to fly in, and we want to be a part of a service. We want to honor our local policemen and firemen, and we want to honor a fireman from. He said, well, I'll just put the note on the board, and if somebody sees it, I said, oh, okay, thanks. That was it. And so I thought, well, you know, we'll just go on and do it. Well, I get a call from Charles Harris, this guy right here. Now, Charles was a fireman who was over all the funerals of the firemen who lost their lives in the Twin Towers, and I believe there were over 300 that lost their lives. And he was in charge of all those funerals. And we talked on the phone, and I told him how I wanted him to come here to Landmark, and we wanted to honor him, and that would have been the first Sunday in November. Well, he kept dropping some big bombs on the phone. I mean, blankety blank, blank, blankety blank. And I said, whoa. And I didn't really, I said, he'd apologize about his language. And I said, that's all right. I'm used to it with my wife. But, you know, I just, he just kept dropping them. I didn't say anything. And I just figured it was a New York thing. And so when he and Sergeant Karen Delaney came in late on a Friday night, it was at the Dayton Airport, and I was just sitting on the floor 10:30 at night, and you know, I knew who they were, but they didn't know me. They looked at me and they said, there's no way, that dude's the pastor. And they just kept walking on, and I thought, wow. And they walked right to the baggage claim. So I walked up to them and I told them who I was, and they went, wow. And blankety blank blank, you know, and I went, wow, it's good to meet you. And we got in the car, and I was just driving back to Cincinnati, and it was, man, blank, thanks, Pastor, blankety blank blank, Pastor, and blank blank. And I'm going, God, please don't let him say that stuff on Sunday morning. And Karen, the sergeant, said, Charles, this is a church. This is a church. You can't talk like that. He said, I'm sorry, Pastor, it's just the way we talk up in New York. And I said, well, I figured it was. But once again, I'm used to my wife talking like that, so it's okay. I'm teasing. So we were on Channel 5 on Saturday. The local news wanted to do, and I just said, God, please don't let him drop those bombs on Channel 5, please. And then on Sunday morning, you know, he said, Pastor, come up here and, man, take my hand, because I never know what's going to come out of my mouth. And I said, oh, man, Lord, please don't let him. But it was cool. He did. And then when the invitation was given, he was kneeling right down here at the altar, and he gave his heart to Christ. It was a very cool day. It was a very cool day. And, you know, it was great. So I called him this weekend, and thank you, Billy Bacasio, for reaching out to Charles Harris and just, you know, let you know and that we're thinking about him and praying. And when I heard about that text, I called him, and I said, Charles, I said, man, this is Matt, and we talked, and He came here 10 years ago in the 10th anniversary, and then, of course, 20 years ago. I said, hey, would you put together just a little video? And he said, oh, I'm too nervous. I can't do that. I said, man, here, let me give you some bullet points, and, you know, I'm not going to tell you what to say, but just da-da-da-da, just greet everybody at Landmark, because that was such a special day, and we thank you. Well, he said, I'll do that. So his daughter helped him. He put together a little video, and we just got this weekend. So this is Charles Harris.
Hi, I'm Charles Harris from New York. After the 9/11 attacks on the World Trade Center, I was heartbroken, depressed, lost, and so upset. Next thing, I was talking to this crazy pastor on the phone. Pastor Matt was trying to get me to come to Cincinnati to visit. Reluctantly, I went. However, it was the most important event in my life. You loving folks at Landmark Baptist Temple made me feel so welcomed, comfortable, and reconnected. I occasionally went to church and prayed, but after my short visit to Landmark Baptist Temple, I really felt different. And when I got back home, I went to church and publicly accepted Jesus Christ in my heart. Landmark Baptist Temple, I love each and every one of you. Stay safe.
An icon is a small picture or a small image that represents a file or a program. It's like last week when we ended. You know, your body is that you've accepted Christ. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Your Christian personage, you represent God. You represent Jesus Christ. And so there's icons that we see and that are representation of Christ and our representation of freedom. For instance, William Wallace was an icon in 1246 A.D. He was fighting for a Scottish independence. It was in the movie Braveheart, Mel Gibson, who played the part of William Wallace. If you've seen that movie, it's a powerful, powerful movie. But once again, it was a movie and that story based on independence and freedom. By the way, if you follow Mel Gibson on any social media, one of the last social media little blurbs that he put out was the most important person that you could ever follow is Jesus Christ. And in reading what he's been saying, it's obvious that, you know, God is really working on his life and in his life. And in the movies that he's done, like Patriot and, of course, Braveheart, the great movies. And, of course, you know, The Passion of the Christ that he directed. You know, if you haven't seen that movie, what an incredible movie of the last few days of our Christ. But he's an icon. William Wallace was an icon, like Martin Luther King. Martin Luther King was a national icon. He was a Baptist minister who was a spokesman for civil rights from 1955 until, unfortunately, an assassination that happened in Memphis in 1968. But he fought for the civil disobedience that was happening, but in a very non-violent way, that Dr. Martin Luther King, with his strong passion and his drive, and as a spokesman for the people and for America, he was a national icon. These men were national icons that I mentioned. And of course, you know, I feel, you know, when the American flag is unmatched, unparalleled, like anything else, because it is a symbol of patriotism. It is a symbol of freedom. And when we think about the American ideology, the flag, it stands out. I love seeing the flag out. I love seeing the flag being waved. You know, in recent years, if there's a flag here on the property, or if you see, you're out, and you see a flag that's tattered on the end, you say, man, change the flag. Let's get the flag changed. But boy, these days, when you see a flag, I'm thankful to see a tattered flag because I know what it represents. And yesterday, in watching all those 9/11 presentations, they were taking a flag. I want to say it was from the Pentagon or from the Twin Towers, and it was tattered, and it had holes in it. But it was just it symbolizes freedom, like Mount Rushmore. That's a national icon. My parents, we went out there. I was a teenager, and we saw for the first time. I did the Mount Rushmore. It's a national icon, or the Lincoln Memorial, or the Washington Monument. That's a national icon. And one of the most well-known national icons, of course, is the Statue of Liberty there in the harbor of New York. It represents freedom. And it's when you see and I've flown over the Statue of Liberty, and I'm always so thankful and proud that God, you know, has put me where I'm at. And thank you, God, for the freedoms that we have. And when you die to Jesus Christ, when you give your life to Christ, you become an icon for Jesus. You represent Him. You represent the Lord. You are like, when you commit yourself to God, or you commit your will to God's will and say, God, I am willing. And there's so many, like I mentioned, there's so many great men and so many great women who have committed themselves, you know, to the will of God and following Christ and listening to the words, like Oswald Chambers. He has long since gone, but he wrote this devotional book called My Utmost for His Highest. And it's just something, it's like a little paragraph that you can still go online and search Oswald Chambers. And his devotions, his daily devotions will come up and you can read those. And they're so, and he was committed to the will of God, like Jim and Elizabeth Elliot and Jim and his team that went to Ecuador, and they loved those Aqua Indians, those Ecuadorian Indians, but they lost their lives, all five of them, in committing their passion and their drive to lead those Indians to Christ. And then Elizabeth Elliot picking up the flame and finishing the work that her husband's team had been called to do. It's a commitment. So what are you saying? Well, God is looking for that man. God is looking for that woman who will stand up and who will say, I can conquer. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. I want to stand for God. God is looking for those who will stand up and rise up and just say, God, I'm that one. I want to be that one, you know, that takes that story, that shares that story. Now, the Philistines were not a good example, but they were giving us an example in 1 Samuel 4 and in verse 9 and through 11, just those two verses. And these are great verses. Of course, the Ark of the Covenant had been captured by the Philistines because of a couple of guys and how they forgot God. But here's what was being said: fight as never before, Philistines. If you don't, we will become the Hebrew slaves just as they have been ours. Stand up like men and fight. So the Philistines fought desperately, and Israel was defeated again. The slaughter was great. 30,000 Israelite soldiers died that day. The survivors turned and fled to their tents. The Ark of God, and we talked about that in recent weeks, was captured. Hophni and Phinehas, bad dudes, the two sons of Eli, were killed. Hophni and Phinehas had forgot how important God was, and they walked away from the words of God. They wanted to do things on their own. They wanted to operate in their own flesh. They wanted to worship false idols when God had given them deliverance, when God had given them freedom. But they went behind the lines, and they encouraged a lot of people. And because of that, God allowed the enemy to come in and take the Ark of the Covenant, take the Ark of God away. And of course, you see the end result. But when I stand in the flesh and I say, I want to fight, I want to stand up for you, God, and when I have the Holy Spirit, because listen, your calling is greater than any enemy that comes up against you. I'll say it again. Your calling, the calling of God, is greater than any enemy that comes up against you, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. The Bible declares it like this. Matthew 5, verse 13 through 15, it says this: you are the salt of the earth. But what good is the salt if it's lost its flavor? Can you make it salty again? It'll be thrown out, trampled underfoot as worthless. You are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house. This past Friday, I went to get my mother, and my wife was with me, and we went to Cracker Barrel over in Richmond, Indiana. And I said to the young lady that waited on us, I said, listen, over in Cincinnati, we have this Cracker Barrel, and they've been serving Reubens. But since the virus, they stopped serving those Reubens, and I don't know if it has to do with the virus or not. But do you have a Reuben here? Because I've been to a lot of places to serve Reubens. I think it's the best Reuben I've had, and I'm not trying to give you their menu this morning or, you know, say, hey, man, this is a great place to go. But she said, we don't have Reubens. I said, are you kidding? Why? She goes, well, ever since Corona. I said, well, how about some cottage cheese? We don't have cottage cheese. We don't serve that either. I said, really? You kidding me? You know? I said, okay, how about beef noodle soup? Nope, don't have that either. And so, you know, I wasn't ugly, wasn't mean. I said, well, then I want something that's really good for me. Bring those big French fries, about this big, and just, man, I'll take an extra order and just fill up my plate, okay? And so I had that, and I can't remember what, I think I had some fish, so I was a good boy on that. But listen, I took a fry, and it's bland. It's bland without salt. It's got to have some salt. So I took that salt, and I put it all over those French fries. And if you got high blood pressure, I get it. I understand that you're not supposed to. Mine's about here, so it's okay. I don't do as much, but man, it is so good without the salt. It's bland, and it's bland. And so that's what the watching world is watching, and they need a little salt. They need a little flavor. They need a little savor. It's like, this is encouraging. And by the way, I wasn't mean or ugly to that waitress. I said, I get it. By the time we were laughing and we were blaming everything, you know, on Corona, and we understand and blah, I don't get it, but we understand. And so you just get the next best thing if you can. So I had a funeral on Friday, the McDowell funeral, Kim McDowell. And I'm standing over here at the break, and I'm just waiting for the service to start. And here's this lady, and she walks over to me. You see, every Friday for the last 3 years, Duke and Sandy Herring and myself, my wife, we go to a restaurant and we'll eat, and we've been there 3 years now, and we've made friends with all the waiters and all the waitresses, and this lady came over and she said, hey, my daughter, you know, who had a child, wanted me to tell you and Joy hi and that she loves you, and please tell Duke and Sandy Herring that she, and she, I said, hey, that is, it made us feel so good. Because here's why, I hope she's not listening, but man, she's a wild child, and she's out there on the range now, and her mom has been praying for her, and I find all this out. Well, we just try to be Jesus to her. Well, we just try to be friends to her. I even called her Sister April, and she said, I've never been called Sister April before in my life. She said, that's funny. And so we have this throwing salt out there. A little dash of salt, a little dash of grace, a little dash of love, a little dash of mercy, a little dash of salt. Walk into a dark room, a Christian. You know, what you give off light. It's because you're following Christ, because the watching world is watching. And the unbelieving world is simply saying, why is Christianity so necessary? Well, it's because that when I turn my back on the enemy, I say yes to Jesus, I say yes to heaven, and I say no to hell. And so the watching world is watching. And once I do that, you know, the Holy Spirit takes residence in my life. I commit myself, and my faith, listen, My faith is measured by my devotion. Colossians 1, verse 18. I mentioned this verse last week. I got it in writing here this week. Christ is also the head of the church, which is his body. He is the beginning, supreme over all who rise from the dead. So he is first in everything. Can you say that last little line with me? So he is first in everything. Say it again. So he is first in everything. That means I give him the first part of my day. I give him the first part of my money. I give him the first part of my relationships. I give him the first part of my job. I give him the first part of my friends. I give him the first part of everything because he's preeminent. He's got to be first in my life. That I know that if he's living in me, that I can stand and I can have dominion and I can have power that God promises us. So my faith is measured by my devotion. My faith is measured by my obedience. And my faith is measured by my length of sacrifice. You know, on Mount Moriah, when Abraham and Isaac went to the mountain and Abraham was there to sacrifice Isaac, it wasn't Isaac that God wanted. He wanted Abraham. He wanted his heart. He wanted to know that he was getting ready to tell Abraham, listen, back a few chapters or a few books or one book, we're in the book of Genesis, he said, you are going to be the father of many nations. And he took him through a series of tests. And he was saying, listen, I want to give you this, and I want to do this for you, and I want to bless you, and your seed will be as innumerable as the sands of the sea. And look up into the stars, Abraham. I'm going to multiply your blessings and multiply. You just continue to listen to me. You continue to follow me, and I will make you great. And see, the church of Jesus Christ is given dreams and visions and these things of God to help us move throughout the communities, move beyond the four walls to help people who are in need and people who, you know, who need Jesus Christ. Now in Scripture, this church, this icon, this quintessential icon, if you will, is referred to as a body. And I was just reading this morning in 1 Corinthians 12 how the church is like a body, and the church is like a family, and then the church is like an army. You have a body of believers. You have a faith of a family, and then you have the responsibility of an army. And what is the responsibility of an army? It's to attack. What is the number one enemy that we face? Satan. Satan is the greatest enemy. He is not omnipresent like God, but he can move around and he can be in places where God is moving, and he can oppress and he can bring about the bitterness and the anger, and he can and make us anxious and bring in the depression and bring in the anxiety. But once again, we say that greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world, that he's promised us victory over the world, the flesh, and the devil, and that your calling to God is greater than any enemy that you face. And he'll find his way in. He'll get into a youth group. He'll get into a music, a group of musicians. He'll get into a media. He'll get into people who are trying to have a small group. He'll get into Christians who are trying to live right and do the right thing. And man, he just, wow, and it's constant. And so we just have to put on the full armor of God that talks about in the book of Ephesians, and just put it on and read the word of God. I'm giving God first place, so I got to give him the first part of every day. So I've got to be in the word, and I got to read the word, and I got to, God, you got to help me today as I follow in your will. And the greatest enemy that we face, Number one is Satan. The second one is me. Write it down. I didn't see anybody taking a pen out, because I know, you know, the second greatest enemy is me. I'm my own worst enemy. I'm my own worst adversary. I'm always coming up against me. Oh, I'm saved. I'm sanctified. I know Jesus. But I'm just bent. Our bodies are bent on walking contrary to God's will. We're bent on it. And you know, it's a constant reminder. You know, the Holy Spirit is, you know, we can grieve the Holy Spirit, but he's convicting us. And that is, wow, that's such an important part of our salvation, is that when I'm walking contrary, the Holy Spirit's convicting me because he loves me and he's drawing me back and he's calling me back, because there's power here. There's Hophni and Phinehas power over here. He wants you to be in Holy Ghost power. He wants you to walk in the Spirit. Galatians 5, 13 through 18. Let me read it to you. You have it up on the board. Here's what Paul's saying. For you have been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters. But don't use your freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. Powerful. Instead, use your freedom to serve one another in love. When I finish reading chapter 12, tomorrow I'll read chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians. But that begins, you know, all about love. You can do this and you can do that in the name of God, but without love, it's like just a crashing cymbal. It's nothing. Love is the strength of the church. Love brings it all together. And this is what the writer Paul is saying. Well, listen to this. For the whole law can be summed up in this one command. Love your neighbor as yourself. But if you're always out biting and devouring one another, watch out. Beware of destroying one another. So I say, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives. Then you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. Boy, that's a promise. I better read that one again. So I say, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives. Then you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. The sinful nature wants to do evil, which is just the opposite of what the Spirit wants. And the Spirit gives us desires that are opposite of what sinful nature desires. Now, this is powerful. Listen, these two forces are constantly fighting each other. Oh, can I get an amen? So you are not free to carry out your own good intentions. Boy, they're constantly fighting against one another. You know, I want to do this, God. I'd rather do this. And it's back and forth. That's what Paul's saying. And band, you can come up. Band, we'll get ready to close. Let me say this. Paul did not write those verses to the unbelieving world. He didn't write that to heathens. He wrote these verses right here to the church of Jesus Christ. Here's what he's saying. When you walk in the Spirit, you'll do things mine to the Spirit. That's why it's so important, Colossians 1:18, that you give Jesus the first part of everything. When you give Jesus number one, first part, boom, 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 everything just seems to fall in place. It doesn't mean that everything's always going to be in place, but it just means that everything's going to fall in place because you're honoring God with your life. And when you walk in the Spirit, you'll do things mind of the Spirit. When you walk in the flesh, you'll do things mind of the flesh. There's a fight. And so the one that you feed the most is the one that's going to be the strongest. And if he's promised us, I'll say it again, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. You have victory over the world, the flesh, and the devil. You can't do this on your own. You've got to have the Holy Spirit's power inside of you living in. That's the same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead. So I'd say that's really good power that you possess when you've called on Christ. So I asked the Lord, I said, Lord, boy, these are difficult days. Man, they're just wild. It seems like it's out of control. And I said, Lord, like Romans chapter 8, you know, what do we pray for? How do we pray as followers? And sure, you pray for, you know, you want to pray for those who've lost loved ones, and you pray for our country, and you pray for those who don't experience like freedoms that we do, and pray for the church, and you pray for other people, you pray for people. But it kept coming back to me, boy, we got to pray for our young people. We got to pray for our young people across the community, across the country, and the world. We have to pray for our young people. And as Jason, I picked up on what he was saying, Jason Snow, in that video. He said, I've done my 20 years. I want to train the next generation that's coming behind me. And this is it. This is what David said, King David. He said, I want to help those who are coming behind me, the generation and the generation after that. And once again, it's being an icon for God and an icon for Jesus and saying, Lord, help me to be the salt of the earth. Help me to be the light in a very dark world. I want to pray, you know, and man, some of these young people down here are scattered throughout, you know, the auditorium. They look up and they see what happened yesterday or on the TV and what happened 20 years ago and they weren't around and it may not register. It may not register. I get it. When I was a kid, you know, I didn't even think about attacks on this land. I'd hear of wars and read of wars, you know, out of the country and other parts of the world. And you just never, ever thought that anything like that could ever happen in our own country. And then it did. Then it did. And you think, man. And then you understand, you realize Jeremiah that said, you know, the heart is wicked. More than anything, it's nobody knows the evil intent of people. And it's just hard to understand. And so you pray for these young people. And we just, you know, when 9/11 happened, a lot of these young people, they, you know, they don't know what Desert Storm was, or, you know, they don't know what Black Monday was, or Tiananmen Square, or when the Soviet Union fell apart, or when Reagan got shot. And they don't even, Kevin, they don't even know who Grand Funk Railroad is, and that's a shame. That's a shame. It's true. Man, we pray. But when that happened, when Desert Storm happened, wow, I remember back here in the chapel, people came and we were praying. When 9/11 happened, boy, there were people coming together and they were praying. Prayer is so important. It strengthens us. It brings us like that body family. There's unity. There's solidarity. It brings us together. We unite because we're, you know, one purpose and one mind. Just like the upper room experience, there was one purpose and one mind, and then the Holy Spirit fell just as he was promised. I was reading this morning in this one of my devotionals about a young man who was just facing a lot of anxiety in his life. And every one of you, you know of someone who's, you know, has a lot of anxiety. And, you know, a church setting, sometimes the people, they don't want to be transparent, or they don't know how to be transparent and to share what they look as inadequacies or a weakness, and so they'll keep it within themselves. And that was this young man's issue. He was just a lot of panic attacks, a lot of anxious moments. So he began to share with some people, and they were giving him Bible verses and, you know, giving him scripture. And he said, the more verses I read, the worse I got. And he said, Lord, I'm supposed to be getting better, and I don't get it. And he just, man, he was just closing up. And, you know, he was trying to be consistent in his reading. But really, that prayer piece. And if Satan is going to attack any one of us in this room, he's going to do so by keeping us away from the altar of prayer. He's going to keep us away from it. Because that's where our power lies. And man, when we begin to pray, boy, the demons just shake in their boots. Because there's something about the power and the privilege of prayer when we come together and we begin to pray. And he said he began to pray. And I'm not saying that, you know, he didn't go to counselors, because even the Bible says there's wisdom in the midst of counselors. And so God, you know, just pray. If you're dealing with that yourself, or you're going through that, find a, you know, a Christian a man, a Christian woman, someone that you know that is great counselor and can help you through these moments. But man, he said when he started to pray, he said there was just a release. There was just a release in his spirit and more. Does he still struggle with some of it? Absolutely, but he said it's been minimized. And the more and more I focus on Christ through the power of prayer, it just seems like God is freeing my spirit. There's nothing like freedom. Jesus Christ came to die for our freedom, that we could be free in Christ, that we could be free from the bondage of sin, and that he would get all the praise and all the glory. So let's stand together. And I don't know what you're going through this morning, but if you need someone to talk to you about salvation, or you're just going through some anxious moments in your life, or man, the sin or walking contrary has just been evident and obvious in your life, just find a place here at this altar. You can stand or kneel and pray by yourself. Bring somebody with you, or somebody here at the front will just pray with you if you choose, if you desire to do so. So as Mike leads us in this song, as the team leads us in this time of worship, the altar is now open.